Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening. Welcome to the StarCraft II TeSPA Collegiate Series. I'm Nathanius. Joining me is Rotterdam. We are here for day two. We have a lot of StarCraft coming up in this tournament. This is day two of many to come, Kev.
Yeah, three more best of fives today. We did three best of fives yesterday, and it was a lot of fun. Obviously, very different to what we normally do, especially in a studio like this. You know, every now and then you sit at home and you cast a couple of matches, but yesterday I think it was really cool. I even got a very lovely message of one of the players who said, hey man, I'm sorry I didn't put up a better fight. I was like, oh, come on, man. You went up against Intense and Xeno, you know, take it easy on yourself. But I really enjoyed it. But today, Nate, I am going to enjoy it even more. Because yesterday, there was just one thing missing from the broadcast.
I don't know what you're talking about. I thought yesterday was totally fine. We don't have a hammer on the desk for me to...
No, I need to see some probes, and I need to see some actual Archons.
I should just go get the flail from over there.
I will stop you. It was a lot of fun, but obviously I'm very excited to cast a little bit of Protoss today as well, because, you know, we were speculating what would be good in Archon, and obviously every race can be very good, because every race has things that are very intense when it comes to the multitasking department, but I would love to see Warp Prisms and Disruptors, you know, and unless you're Stork, having two people doing that is a little bit easier.
I see that. And, you know, we were talking a little about the format. So for those of you guys that don't know, this is a collegiate series that's spanning all across the United States and Canada. We've got Western region, the Northern region, the Eastern region, and the Southern region. And looking at this map, Kev, that does mean Pennsylvania is in the Eastern region. There's a lot of teams signed up. I actually tried to look through it, but there are actually too many for me to look through. Over 130 colleges competing. Of course, this is open season, 7 weeks. Every team plays one match a week. Then we go to the playoffs, where we just grind down a bracket and get to the grand final. And of course, $50,000 scholarship money on the line. It is, it's pretty awesome when you can see, you know, you're just a college kid. You're like, hey, I like to play StarCraft. Just so happens I have a friend who likes to play StarCraft. We could possibly get our tuition paid for.
I mean, this is one of the things we always say, but it's just so true. Competing is fun. And even if you're not at Grandmaster League level, or even if you're not the best in your server or on your server or in your region, it's just fun to play against people that are, you know, relatively on the same level than you. And of course, in a league like this, you will run into a couple of teams that are probably quite a bit better than you, but you can see that as a learning experience. You can still try to, you know, you may have always had this one build where you're like, if I ever play against a very good player, this is the build I'm going for. So I think we're going to see a lot of unique stuff, and overall I'm just excited. You know, it's always fun to be part of a competition, and this competition also allows us to brush up our geography skills a little bit, because every now and then I see university names and I was like, I've got no idea what it is.
Our first matchup is going to be the Universite Laval, which is apparently from northern Montreal, up against NYU, New York University.
Where's that again, Nate?
Very, very funny. I actually don't know how far that is from Brooklyn, but yeah.
I think NYU, if I recall that correctly, is on Manhattan.
I believe it's New York City. I'm just saying, I don't know. Relative to where I'm from, at least.
Okay. But I think it's not too far from the Javits Center, you know, the big convention center?
Yeah.
Then if you go up, like, you know, let's say 15 blocks and a little bit up to the north, I believe that's where it is.
I'd say anywhere in Manhattan, you could say, is relatively close to anything else.
Well, Manhattan is like as big as my entire city, Nate. I wouldn't go that far.
Welcome to America.
Either way, we are already loading into the first best of five of the day. It's going to be a lot of fun.
PVZ.
Going to be PVZ. The Zergs are double Master League. Meanwhile, in the Protoss department, we've got one Master League and one Platinum player. So normally, you know, just looking at the profiles, looking at the ranks, you say, all right, the Zerg Archon duo should be favored over here, but you know, this is Archon mode after all. Nothing really matters. You know, if the Protoss player is actually superior to the other two Zerg players, there's a good chance that he will still be able to close it out with a little bit of help from his partner.
And they are, of course, Protoss. So, you know, I'd say at the very least it's even as we are getting ready, as we're getting loaded in to the first map of today's matches. We're loaded into Ruins of Saris and spawning in the top right position. We have Universite Laval team, the Protoss Archon in red.
I was waiting for the big name, but I realized that you already said the name. I was just kind of thinking of Desero, you know, because we're looking at French-Canadian Protosses.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, they must have been inspired at least a little bit by the lovely panda bear that is Desero. Over here on the left bottom side, we're looking at the main base of our blue Zerg Archon duo. They're representing NYU, Calgrass. Calgrass. Call me Steve, and the other name was supposed to be Asian Color, or AZN color, but call himself grass over here. I guess it works. Whatever works for them works for me. Now.
I like the team descriptions. We do have some notes from the teams. They were asked to submit a little snippet about themselves. According to NYU, one of the players just does everything, and the other guy just pairs drones. So
he stacks drones?
Yeah. Apparently, the Call Me Steve guy literally just keeps the drones paired on the mineral patches.
I mean, there
these drones look pretty well paired.
But there is a good chance, you know, that they were trolling a little bit in these answers. I saw one of the other comments. So, one of the teams said, like, yeah, my job is to make sure that the APM stays high, so I'm just clicking around. I'm pretty sure he does more than just clicking.
You say that, but I've actually, like, watched some people play an Archon game, and one person literally just had, like, a keybind just spamming APM, clicking an Overlord back and forth 1,000 times a second.
But why? Well, you're not going to win $50,000 in the Collegiate Series by clicking an Overlord left and right, Nate.
Yeah, but, you know, APM's good for the ego.
Alrighty, so taking a look at the openings over here, everything is relatively standard. This was, of course, a Nexus first for our Protoss Archon duo. I think it's a little bit risky to build your buildings over here, because if they would have got 12 pulled, there is no way they will ever be able to hold it. The Pioneers will get unpowered and they lose. This is why you often see pro Protoss players drop their first Pioneer on the high ground, and then drop a gate and a gate here.
Yeah, so they're bringing out some special tactics already.
But I can blame them, because I do this too. And if you guys wonder, like, well, Roddy, if you know it's bad, why are you doing it? I'm stubborn, okay.
You know, it feels good when you get away with it.
Yes,
you know?
Because I like sitting behind a wall. Like, it doesn't feel right to me knowing that Zerkin can just always run up these almost like Philadelphia-esque Rocky Balboa stairs over here, and they can just run into your mineral line, pick up a probe. I really hate it. I find it annoying. So.
And that is, you're right, that's a long set of stairs, and they just run right up.
Mm-hmm. You would expect them to be exhausted.
Yeah.
Have you seen the latest Rocky movie yet? It's really good.
I have not. I was going to say, actually, I'm hoping that we see some Philadelphia teams as well. Should be a few.
Yeah. Double Adept is the opening for now. Mothership Core is on the way too. So far, everything looks actually pretty solid in this game. You know, if we wouldn't have known any better, this could have been anybody playing. This could have been two relatively high-level players playing. It's a little bit unfortunate whenever you open up with Double Adept and it's cross-map. Of course, cross-map will give you time to complete this wall, so that is, you know, the plus side. The downside is that it takes much longer for these adepts to make their way across the map, so it's much more likely that your opponents will be ready, especially when it's not one, but two Zergs playing at the same time. At least one of them should be ready for adepts, right?
Yeah, definitely. Speedlings, though, coming out, trying to catch these adepts on the map. They're going to throw the shadows and try to run. One of them going to get picked off. The second one gets so close, and dies, too.
Okay.
Unfortunate.
Rough start. This is actually not a proper I guess this
is that probe
fine.
Have broad enough shoulders, Kev?
Well, yes, the probe will, but the probe will also die, so it's really important that the stock... I do like that they temporarily had this probe over here on hold position, so... But they need to swap it out. The Zerglings are coming, though, so don't do it right now. No, actually...
One Link slips around.
I think they would have just been able to run by if you would have really gone for it.
Probe's got to go back to the gym. Ooh, Overlord speed's on the way. Which makes me think, Roddy, the Overlord drop upgrade does not show up on the production tab in the current version of StarCraft 2.
I was wondering about it. I was keeping a close eye on it the other day, and then suddenly there were two Overlords that were able to drop, and I was like, okay, that's, you know, did I miss this?
Yeah,
I know it's a quick upgrade, but I didn't think it was that quick.
It doesn't show up on the production tab just yet, so we have to be very careful. But on the same hand, we don't actually have an evolution chamber on the map, so they can't actually drop any Overlords.
Maybe these guys are a fan of Destiny. I know that Destiny loves this very early on Overlord speed, because it will allow you to scout so much better as a Zerg player. One Overlord is cruising through the main base, meanwhile Zergling still harassing over here. This is kind of solid. It's also pretty good against Phoenixes, because it's a lot easier to save your Overlords, obviously, if you have got Overlord speed.
Yep, they can pull out any of the Overlords that they would have already had on the map, so they know about the third base, they know no gas on the natural expansion, but that's also because they just want to keep that probe count nice and high. Lair's finishing up, Roach Warren is coming in, and this looks like a pretty straightforward PvZ, Kev. Is there anything here that really stands out to you as being unusual or out of the ordinary?
I would say that the third and fourth gas is rather late over here, and a very quick expand for Protoss while going Phoenixes, only being on two gases and then going up to three bases. It's very ballsy. I think if the Zerg Archon duo from NYU would have just produced 22, 24 Zerglings, they would have been able to shut this down. Absolutely no problem, because Phoenixes can't really lift links. But other than that, no, Nate, you're right. It's pretty standard, pretty much the usual.
All right. Evolution Chambers finishing up. Hydralis down on the way.
Yeah, okay, now not something like this as much anymore. Like, I don't know what they're going for, but start mining dead. Oh, Lynx actually managed to sneak by. I have no idea how that happened, but somehow it happened.
Yep, the Lynx make their way into the main base, and there's not too much to see here as the Phoenix crossover. She will pick off this queen. 1-1 starts up for NYU, but two probes get picked off by the Lynx, and they're just being annoying. But you're right, we aren't seeing too much of a follow-up here out of Laval.
Yeah, they've got a bunch of gateways down. They've got a Twilight, but just now, Charge is being researched. I really felt they could have gone for that a lot quicker. Meanwhile, the macro on the other side of the map for NYU was excellent. I mean, they went up to 68 drones already. That's really solid. The only thing I would have loved to see more is a fort base. We do see one drone heading over now, gonna try to plant that fort hatchery down, but things are starting to look really good. And as we all know, Roaches are very good against Zealots with Charge. In my opinion. Some Zergs say they're not, but they're lying. Don't believe their lies.
Roddy, if there's one person I would trust to know what beats Charge Zealots, it would be you.
I know, I've made quite a few in my days.
You're the guy that keeps the Zealots in the build order tab. That's why everybody builds Adepts these days. But we do have that War Prism coming out too, like you said, the Phoenix. You know, pushing these queens back will also make it more difficult to deal with the Prism that comes out over towards their side of the base. The only thing, no Forge. Okay, Forge is just now starting, and they're getting a lot of kills with these Phoenix.
But they do have Immortals already, correct? How many Immortals? One. If they would have three Immortals, then I start believing in the Zealots again. I mean, I always believe in the Zealots, like you were mentioning it. The Adepts, Nate, they're fine, but you know what they say. Nothing really compares to your first true love, and I fell in love with the Zealot many, many years ago.
Very poetic, Kev.
I can't just let it go, okay? But I would love to see them back off, because against this many Roaches, and now a couple of Ravagers on the way as well.
I don't think there's an Observer. Yeah, there's no Observer on the map, so they can't clear the creep. If they step forward, they're committing to something that they can't really change their minds about.
Questionable. There are force fields over here, so maybe with a couple of force fields, you got to make up your mind. Universite Laval, I should say. Universite. They're going to just run away. Maybe a couple of defensive force fields would have helped in just trying to retreat. Immortals are really needed. They're going for Blink now, which is not...
Oh, no.
Actually,
and they triggered the Immortal. Yep.
Shield. Whoa, he's trying to block with the Zergling. That's like Warcraft 3 micro over there. Or maybe that was by accident. Either way, they pick up an Immortal. There is another Immortal remaining, but that's a very, very expensive loss. And I don't think they ever had to lose the Immortal there.
And, well, you said it. Those Roaches are going to be able to take out these Zealots pretty handily. The Phoenix are trying to take the Ravagers out, so getting a bit of work done there. It's something.
Yeah, overall, I still think this is looking pretty solid for Laval. Even though, I mean, it's hard to reinforce cross-map, and the Phoenixes are, you know, slowly but steady chipping away. Lifting up one of these Ravagers here. Expensive unit, you don't want to lose it.
Yeah, getting rid of the Ravagers is really nice. They have the money to crank out quite a few more Ravagers if they wanted. They're going into Hydras, though. 2-2 is on the way. Lurker Den coming in as well.
I like that you mentioned it, Nate. It's something that I, you know, like we talk about upgrades all the time in TVT in particular, but also in, I think PVZ upgrades are mentioned sometimes early on, but in these current unit compositions, people kind of look at it like, well, Immortals and Archons are always good against Roaches, and that's true, but every now and then you see these scenarios where Zerg will have 2-2, and then the Protoss army is 1-0, and just because, you know, there's not like some golden rule, you know, you kill it in X amount of units, it makes a massive difference, you know, like Lurkers and Roaches and Hydras with 2-2 upgrades against a 1-0 Protoss army. Protoss army is going to struggle no matter how many Immortals or Archons you may have.
Yeah, especially when you consider the, you know, if the Zealots ever end up in the battle late game-wise when they're coming in against Lings and whatnot. Mm-hmm. But that max out for NYU, man, it's looking pretty damn good. Infestation Pit is going to follow up so they can go into Hive, get extra upgrades. And the Robo Bay, the second Robo, the plus one, it all just feels a little late.
Yep, 23 seconds left on that Lurker then, and then we might be able to see the first Lurkers, even though NYU is maxed out now, so they might just go for it. A couple of Zealots will just run straight into their death again. That's why, you know, against Mass Roach, Zealots can be a little silly sometimes. But a couple of Zealots in the back are just not doing anything, Nate.
Oh, well, they're actually just standing there. Yep. All right. Definitely not being as useful as they otherwise could be. That Void Ray is going to overcharge itself, trying to do something here. But, I mean, there's just so much NYU. They're still maxed out. More Hydras coming across the map. A few more Roaches. Pathogen Glands.
I mean, this is 2-2 upgrades against 0-0. Yeah. Plus one is done right now. But
these units are just absolutely demolishing their opponents. GG gets called, and NYU takes the first game.
Yeah, definitely very solid play by them. You can see that they are experienced Zerg players and they know what they're doing.
It was just a super straight up, like, yep, we are just going to mac up to three bases, take our fourth, max out and kill you. And that's what happened.
Overlord speed, 68 drones, not really lose all that many. Make a couple links early on, shut down the first two adepts immediately. And once again, it may not seem like a big investment, but if you open up with two adepts and they do absolutely nothing, you can say, like, well, they force out the links. But yeah, most of the time those links will be produced anyway. And those links paid for themselves because picked up a couple of probes here and there. They managed to sneak into the main base. That was a really good play by the Zerg Archon duo. And yeah, if I play Protoss and game number one goes like that in the best of five, I start shivering in my boots already a little bit because I know this is probably not going to be a very pleasant series.
Yeah, definitely a rough start for them as map number one does get picked up by NYU. Keep in mind, it's a best of five. And you know, it all starts with a little bit of harass going out, getting caught. I mean, I guess in Archon mode, you can have one person dedicate to those Phoenix and whatnot, but whoever was working on the follow-up just was a bit slow to the draw.
Yeah, I would have loved to see... You know, also moving into the middle of the map where you don't really want to fight, when you've got two sentries and one immortal, that didn't really make a whole lot of sense to me. Like, if they get up to four immortals there and two, three archons, you know, roaches and hydra are still very scary, but that makes it a manageable position.
I'm kind of excited for game two, just even outside of this match, just because Prion Terraces has received a bit of a change today.
It's the patch live.
The map patch went live at about 11 a.m. Pacific time today. So
you're telling me it's safe to ladder tonight?
Yes. I had a lot of fun playing on these maps. Since Prion Terraces feels really weird. The natural has been completely swapped out. Your natural is now a gold. This is the first time it has ever happened in StarCraft 2.
I know. I find it such a bizarre thing. Like, nobody's really focusing too much on it. Everyone's just like, yeah, good change. But after 5 years... Well, almost 6 years by now. It went live like early 2010.
Wings of Liberty beta was out by now, man.
Yeah.
That it's been 6 years. We haven't had it, and it is here today.
I know. After 6 years of playing, suddenly there's a map where it's like, hey, you're natural. It's going to be a gold base. I'm actually kind of surprised that people are not losing their minds over this, because this is esports history, Tasteless.
That's right. We're making esports history here, guys, on Prion Terraces in the bottom right. Our red Protoss team currently down 0-1 Artosis. We have the Universite Laval.
And over here on the left top side of Prion Terraces, we're looking at the blue Zerg Archon duo. They're representing NYU. It is Kel and Grass, or as we should call them, Call Me Steve and AZN Cutter. I love how
you can see that their majors are actually on here too. I didn't realize that. So we have two computer science majors going up against two physical engineering majors.
Ooh. Actually, I didn't even know that either. That's kind of fun.
That's cool.
Oh my god, there is somebody studying political science later today. The teammate of Bills. I love how Bills' major is undecided.
Oh my god, Bills is playing today?
Yeah, Bills is playing.
Bills is from Kansas?
Well, at least he's studying in Kansas.
Oh, I was not aware of that.
Me neither. Hey, but how cool is it that Bills is like undecided? He's like, I'm kind of trying to be pro game over here, so I'm really not sure.
Can I major in dank memes?
Can I major in Protoss? It's like, no, that's actually not
a
thing.
Wait, Kev. Why did NYU take the low ground basis there now? Did they not realize?
Nope. Well, these minerals have a very different color than these minerals. Oh, poor guys.
Wow.
This is probably the base you want to take, not until you're up to four.
They're taking the more exposed base with less fast resource. I mean, I guess they get the gold anyway. It's not bad for creep spread, but I'm a bit surprised. Okay.
That's kind of funny.
That's
actually very funny.
I strongly doubt that was intentional.
They probably realize it real soon and be like, lol, these minerals are blue. Wrong version. Yeah. This is actually so nice for Protoss, but this is gonna mess up my macro so incredibly much. By the way, Nate.
Yeah. I mean, it's gonna throw your builds off.
Yeah, because I think what I would do is immediately transfer like 10 workers from my main to my gold. But then suddenly, you know, everything is going to be different. I guess this is going to be the Zealot Festival of the Century, where it's like
a Zealot. Yeah, you are gonna be able to power up. Like this is gonna be one of those maps where it's just gonna be like mad amounts. Now it's actually gonna be mineral heavy armies because you're not gonna be focused on killing them before they get the gold base. Although I'll probably still go Mass Reapers here because why not? It's a good map for Reapers. Every map's good for Reapers.
All right, so normally this should be a pretty solid opening over here for the Universite of Laval, because, you know, they've got that gold base up and running. Meanwhile, NYU...
And looking at the income tabs, it's interesting. You don't see it break 900 like this, and once they saturate those bases, it's a... That's a good amount of cash flowing in.
At least they are transferring all of their drones towards the gold in the natural. So that makes a lot of sense, and their income will be skyrocketing now as well. But I mean, Actually, I have no idea how to commentate this, because I've never really commentated a game.
I've never casted a game where a pro player had a gold this fast like this.
No, I mean, unless it's like SOS, who would have taken it over here.
Yeah, but then it's a cheese, and you're like, okay.
It's different, you know, like, what is he going to do with it? Okay, he's going to take another gold.
That's the thing about this map change, that this is not only the first time that we have a gold in your natural, but it's also created a situation where we have a gold base that's not used as a cheese, right? Because all the other games that you had a fast gold taken, it's like 99% of the time for some sort of cheesy play, or, you know, it's SOS, but we can't compare gods to men.
Four more overlords are on their way. I really wonder what's going to be popular right now on this map and in this matchup. If we're going to see a lot of, like, maybe Ling Bane, Ling Queen drops. This is not something... Whoa. Guys, no. I do not think... While going Phoenix and just using recall, looking at this Nexus, this is not a Nexus you can defend, Nate. I'm looking at the production tab. Look at it. Keep looking at it, Nate. It's 16 links. There are six more links in the way.
Oh, six drones coming in a lair.
There are 22 links.
They're gonna try to defend this base, it looks like. There's the overcharge on the pylon.
Hope
Stalkers come
good.
Out with the mothership core.
Oh, wow.
They hold.
That was not supposed to happen.
When you've got an early gold, Kev, anything's possible.
With only a single photon overcharge and going Phoenix, I find it actually very, very surprising. These stalkers are going to be in a little bit of a pickle, though.
Lift the stalker! No!
Pull it, Roddy. Lift it.
Well, that's your move now. Lift the stalker.
You know...
I don't remember the first time I saw someone...
Okay, so this is very funny.
Room.
Do you remember the show Kings of Tin?
Yes.
With Wax Steven and...
I was on it. And DJ Weed.
Yeah, and DJ Weed. So he invited Mr. Bitter and me once upon a time on that show. And Carmack got us a bottle of Polish vodka for the show. So, because that was kind of part of it, right? You play team games and you have a couple of drinks here and there. So I started playing a 3v3 and I was on the team with Wax Steven. And I had a bunch of Phoenixes, but I already had a couple of these Polish vodka shots. And they were rather strong. So at a certain point, I wasn't very accurate anymore, so my Phoenixes flew in and I wanted to like lift up some roaches, but I accidentally lifted up the immortal Wax Steven that was like all by itself, and he just lost it. He's like, oh my god, that's such a good move!
You accidentally made a great play.
Yeah, and I was like, oh yeah. And then like Mr. Vitti, he turned around and he looked at me, he's like, that was a misclick, wasn't it? I was like, yeah. And he just started laughing so hard.
We never told
Wax Steven.
Greatest play accidentally made. So for the map where you've got that fast gold, we actually have double Void Ray production for Laval. I guess Void Ray is good against roaches, so?
Yep. No, for sure. Absolutely. Void Rays will allow you to stabilize. Of course, you're going to need something else later on when there are a whole bunch of Hydras on the map. But if they go for a crazy roach off, which is kind of what it's looking like, right? We don't see any additional tech buildings. We only see four gases, and we see double Evo Chamber. Go up to 3-4 Void Rays, man. Prismatic alignment against roaches. Cash money.
Yeah, without the Hydralisk end this game, it is certainly a very strong strategy to go for, considering just how much minerals have. Look at both players, by the way. Both teams, that fleet bacon, both teams are floating a lot of minerals. It's funny to look at. It's just like, well, I'm just not used to having this much.
What I would really love to see, though, Nate, I mean, they will be floating even more minerals if they want to go up to Carriers or Tempest. Exactly. Just get a whole bunch of cannons. That's the only way you're going to keep your minerals low, and you're going to need cannons anyway. What I love to see, if you want to play Mass Air, get plus one, man. Plus one is so good. It's like probably the most underrated upgrade in the game. Like
what about plus one turns the tide?
Phoenixes attack twice, and just like everything just seems to scale so much quicker, because a lot of these air units already deal a lot of damage, so if you make them do even more damage, they just kill everything so incredibly quickly. They could use a recall over here. It's an excellent snipe on that fort base, and the cannons and this void ray will push away these roaches for now. So even though game number one didn't really go all that well for Universite Laval, things are looking so much better. Look at these void rays going to town. You can actually charge another sport. Don't lose your mothership core. Don't lose it. It's going to die.
Oh, well, that's unfortunate. So no recall out for those.
Okay, there are Hydras right now. I'm very worried. I think these void rays are in a little bit of trouble. Probably best to get out of there. Phoenix is going to take one for the team and will die.
So a bit of punishment there. The carriers are on the way. They take a long time to warp in, but when they come out, Like, you do need a good few of them, though. I don't think two is going to be enough to tip over a bunch of Hydras.
If you got other stuff, then it's fine. Like, if you got two carriers full of interceptors and there's only 10 carriers and you've got cannons and stuff as well, then it's okay. But right now, Nate, I agree with you because these Zealots don't have charge yet. Monitor Core died, so only a single Photon Overcharge available. This Forge is going to get picked up immediately. You really don't want to fight with Zealots before you have charge. They just do absolutely nothing.
They're terrible against ranged units.
There's really no other way to put it.
Yeah, non-charge Zealots are. Unless you're getting proxy 2-gated and you only have drones. Yeah.
They're very good up to like 3 minutes and 22 seconds in the game, and that's where they fall off, and you never want to make them again.
And you need charge.
Okay, but still, though, I really feel that Laval is doing a pretty decent job of stabilizing. Just don't overcommit. No, don't fight with carriers when you
carriers
only,
are out.
Only 4 interceptors. I don't like that, though. You should go back.
There's only 1 interceptor on each carrier now. They've lost them all.
The first
carrier being targeted down. Oh, after all that investment, it goes down. Unfortunate. Charge is so close, too.
Yeah, but how many Zealots are remaining? Fall back on the cannons, guys.
I mean,
supply-wise,
they're hanging in there.
Yeah, no, they're doing fine. It would have been awesome to see these Void Rays maybe still be active on the map and sniping on a base. Spire is going down, but that could be good news, actually, for Laval, because they will already have air upgrades, and the Spire obviously will not have any fly upgrades whatsoever.
Did they get +1 in the carrier?
Yes.
Oh, nice. Okay.
But they really just need to chill with this carrier. Like, a carrier with 1 interceptor is probably worse than an unstimmed marine. Like, go back, get 8 interceptors, and then let the party start. No, but it's your core, Photon! Okay, at least the Desperation Photon went down. They will end up losing it again. I really kind of feel if you want to make carries, you should go 3 Stargates as well. Especially if you had a gold base. That is now obviously very mined out. Main base is going to be mined out too. It's unfortunate, man. I really felt that Laval had things going that way. Losing the Mothership Core and then losing a couple of Void Rays and engaging with 2 carriers while only having 4 interceptors. I felt like this made their life so much harder than it ever should have been. Like, look at this carrier, it still only has 1 interceptor.
Yeah, he hasn't had any time to build him up. He's basically every interceptor that comes out is like, I'll go do it myself, and then they die.
Yep, this way. If they get 5 carriers, no, they've got 3 now, right?
Yeah.
A little bit of a link drop over here. I love that.
Link drop.
This is one of these things where Archon Mode really comes into play. They're going Mudalisk as well. That's interesting. Muda's not extremely good against carriers because carriers got too much HP, but if you have overwhelming numbers, then obviously anything is good.
This is a tough spot to be in. The Hydra's continuing to press up. So now we've got 3 pretty much fully loaded carriers are going to help push out here. Not all of the interceptors have been released, though. Need to fight with all of them at once if they want to be able to turn the tides. One of the carrier's interceptors completely drained. Now taking this fight. But is there enough, Kev?
Yeah, I think there is enough. No, actually, they're losing a lot of interceptors. These Hydras are doing some serious work. What are the upgrades on Hydras?
It's like
again.
Marines versus. I got no interceptors.
It looked a tiny bit promising, but now these Tutu Hydras have just done some serious work.
The carriers are soaking up the damage.
But 2 of them going down. The Archons will clean it up for now, but that's not going to help against these Mudalists that we see on the right top side of the map. Excellent.
I like how
they switched
into Tempest. They're like, well, we gotta do something else. These carriers apparently don't work very well.
Yeah, unfortunately, Tempest don't work very well either against Mudalisk. I think this might actually be it soon. I don't really see how Protoss is gonna be able to stabilize anymore. They do have 2 Stargates, so you could try to squeeze out as many Phoenixes as possible, but I don't know, man. Oh, one of the Stargates is gonna get unpowered. Nope. Look at the Tempest.
That is unfortunate. It's 2 Phoenix. Trying to squeeze them out. Now it's just 1 being produced.
I mean, the macro is just really good from NYU, right? Like, they've been taking a lot of bases. They took a little bit of an economic hit early on, losing that 4th base, almost losing their, what was their natural, but supposed to be their 3rd base. They were able to save that one with Queens and Hydras, and I think from that point on, things just went their way. It really all came down to that first engagement, and I really think that if Laval would have just been a tiny bit more patient, throw down another Photon Overcharge, let the cannons do a little bit of damage on those Hydras and whatnot, and then maybe charge is almost ready, and then you've got 2 carriers with 8 interceptors, I think they would have cleaned that army up immediately. And from that point, they could have been the aggressor again and maybe do something at the left top side of the map.
Yeah, but right now they've got a bunch of roaches being forced down their throats as the Hive starts 3-3 upgrades. And that third base getting picked off, you know, the natural. As nice as it is to have that fast gold, it mines out so quickly. And there's just not that much here to defend this front base. The Tempests are going to try to push up. The Archons doing everything they can. Phoenix lifting. Stalkers coming down. But the Archons especially, definitely one of the most important parts. We have Corruptors coming out too.
Yeah, just to shut down the Tempest and Void Rays, I guess, because they don't really have that main Hydralisk anymore. But once again, look how low they keep their money. It's actually pretty impressive because they've been on four bases, of which two of them have been a gold for a while. Obviously, the Natural is mined out right now as we speak. But still, I'm pretty impressed with the macro over here from NYU. It's just been really solid. It's been on point, and they've been taking the right fights.
Yeah, they've done it pretty much all the way. They completely surround this army, jumping right on top of it, and the carriers fall, as does everything else. GG is called, and NYU takes game number two.
So even though NYU is up 2-0 right now, I really think there is still hope for Laval, because this was a game where they really put themselves in a decent spot. I don't mind the double Stargate at all. I think it's pretty decent in most scenarios, especially against all these roaches early on. That was a massive investment. They shut it down.
Yeah, they had everything they needed to stop it. I think you made the best point where it was just like, losing the Mothership Core obviously hurts a lot. Mm-hmm. Need to just find a way to buy time and build the carriers. Because the thing is, like, it's like any tier 3, right? It's like one Broodlord does not push an army back.
Did they even have the carrier upgrade?
I actually don't think they did.
No, if I...
The one that makes them launch interceptors really quickly?
Yes.
No, I don't think they had it.
That is very, very important. Okay, there it is. Yeah, so they start fighting before that upgrade is ready, and they lost all their interceptors. So not only did they fight with only four interceptors, they also were released very slowly. Yeah, I mean, carriers at that point are, once again, they're like unseen marines. They're really not doing all that much.
It's unfortunate. You know, at tier 3, really, you want to make that switch in a big way. You know, I look at it the same way as everything else. And if you want to go Ultras or Broodlords or Battlecruisers, you need a good few of them before you're able to actually, you know, do anything with them.
I mean, it's probably a good thing. I mean, Starcraft 2 wouldn't be the most amazing game ever if you get that one unit out and then the game is just like...
Wow, Kev, really?
So, it makes sense.
I'd say the magic number is, what is it? Five carriers, maybe six or seven battlecruisers, and then two ultras. This is a Terran army.
I mean, if you got five carriers and they've got the interceptor upgrade, and
with plus one, like
and plus one, and they're all fully loaded. Like, that's a very important thing of carriers, because you know there were two carriers, but basically they were only one carrier because they only had four interceptors each. And they didn't have the upgrade, so it was just kind of an underwhelming unit. It's like pew pew pew. Yeah, it's like this was that big investment.
Big investment that did not pay off. We're loaded in to game number three here, as we have our red Protoss team in the bottom left, the Universite Laval, currently down 0-2. The red Archon.
Against our blue Archon, of course, playing as Zerg. They are maybe not from, but they are representing NYU, New York University, probably one of the most famous universities in the country. Right?
I'd say
maybe not like
there's just some schools that you know about if you live from America. Especially,
I think even like if you're European, like obviously people like if as from a European from a point of view that I can speak from, people will always know like Stanford and Harvard.
Yeah.
Schools, but I think after that, like UCLA.
And then
NYU.
So stuff like that. Most people will know those. And then if you get into sports, it's like, you know, everybody will know like USC, Penn State, Michigan.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, as a European, like Michigan is not like one of the first universities people think of. They know the Ivy Leagues, you know, Columbia, Brown, Yale. I guess those are very famous universities as well.
Yeah, I wonder if...
Different life, Roddy would have been there. If Roddy wouldn't have liked Warcraft 3 that much, he would have been a great academic.
Yeah, if Nathan hadn't played as many video games in high school.
we could have just been ready. Like, we could have been like New York Times bestsellers right now, like writing great books, but we decided to play video games.
That's Roddy. I could see you doing that.
What? I would have been a great writer. You know I've got great stories.
That's true. I think your stories come from your experience in esports.
That's true, but still. I would have found a way to make it, okay?
I believe in you, Kev.
In the next lifetime, I'll make it to Yale or Brown, Columbia.
Good luck.
I want to be like, you know, like Gossip Girl.
What?
All right. Speed is on the way, Nate. Everything looks very standard once
again. Dust Towers is the most standard map, right? Mm-hmm. We don't expect anything weird on this map. Weird things rarely happen. What do you like late game wise? Do you think they'll go for the Stargate play again? They've built a Stargate in both their games.
I love Stargate, you know that. I love Stargate like no other Protoss man out there, but I do not feel they're getting maximum value out of their Stargate. I kind of feel their Stargate is just like, let's have a Stargate for the sake of having a Stargate and kill three overlords and be satisfied with it.
So if I could make a request then, because I mean there's a stream delay and everything, like there's no way they could know what I'm saying in time to do it. I would want to see them try that again.
The carrier ones?
The carriers, yeah.
It's not bad. It's absolutely not bad. It's going to be a little bit...
I remember when they made a bunch of changes to the AI in the beta for Legacy of the Void, they also reduced the build time of the carrier, and it was actually super good, and you saw almost every Protoss try to get to them while
Everyone
surviving.
Everyone went mess there, like triple Stargate, 20 Phoenix, plus one carrier.
Yeah. It was awesome. As long as you weren't playing versus it. Well, I had Cyclones, and they were in beta, OP in the beta too.
So if I can give them, you know, a little bit of advice from what I've seen so far, I feel like if you make a Stargate, you open up with multiple Phoenixes, make it a real commitment, you know. Don't stop at three Phoenixes and be happy after you kill two Overlords, but I'm not sure about the adept timing over here.
They get caught in ruins of Ceres, and they get caught here, they do slip out.
Yeah, but Zerglings are on the hunt, though. They smell blood in the water, Nate. I would have ran up these rocks. I think that would have been a better choice.
Try to hide.
Yeah.
Get inside of a box, maybe.
Adept, adept. You can run.
Oh, look at that. The other two adepts are here. It's like, bros, we got you.
All right.
It's all good.
So once again, very quick
the
Stargate
rest of, the rest
and
of the
Robo.
Frat showed up, Roddy.
Yeah. They take that turret and fort gas incredibly late. It's an interesting build. In a way, I kind of like it, but I think you die against link floods. Like, if they make, instead of 22 links, if they make 32 links, I don't see how two Adepts and a Mercy Pro will ever save the day. And then if your third and fourth gas is so late. But it's interesting though, because obviously if you delay your gases, like Laval is doing over here, that means that you've got way more minerals, and then you can drop expense a little bit quicker, you can drop more pylons, so... I'm not saying it's a bad build, it's kind of interesting actually. Either way, my main focus was, before we saw this whole Adept skirmish, is... If you make Phoenixes, really commit to it, you know, go for 6, 7, 8 Phoenixes, be super annoying, lift up drones all game long, don't stop at 3 or 4, because Phoenixes just can't do that much, you know, there's not enough energy for them to do tremendous amounts of damage, or terrible, terrible damage, so to speak. Just go 7, 8 Phoenixes, really, make it a big commitment.
Go for the Roddy Phoenix.
There's nothing wrong with the Roddy Phoenix.
So we have the Lair starting up just now. And Spore Crawler's coming in, so they're getting ready to deal with the Phoenix. A little bit of a supply block, not a huge deal. Evolution Chambers. I guess we're expecting Laval to go probably with a Roach Warren 2 and just play straight up like they did the last couple games. It's worked so far.
Yep. I mean, considering the fact, if you look at your opponent, right, you always want to kind of adapt a little bit to the playstyle of your opponent in the series, or at least take notes and identify weaknesses. The Hydralis Den is always very late, so if they would have gone double Stargate, like 10, 12, 14 Phoenixes game, I think that would have been super effective. And let's not forget, you're playing Archon Mode, so even though controlling Phoenixes can be difficult, because as a Protoss player, you obviously have to look at your main base whenever you want to build a unit, whenever you want to wipe in a unit. It's not as easy as Terra, where you can just queue up 5 Rexes full of units and still look on the other side of the map.
Wow.
Caparino, Nate.
It's that easy, Roddy. I could press 5SV to drop depots.
Well, you've got that little help to call down for supply depots, I believe it's called, you know. Now, either way, in Archon Mode, you can always, one player can always look at the Phoenixes on the other side of the map.
Yeah, that's true.
While the other person can focus at the main base at home.
I was saying this yesterday. It's like, yeah. If we were going to play, I would always want to do the Phoenix. That's like, you know, it's like, okay, I won't mess up your build, just let me kill some stuff. That's the dream. All those two overlords, they're hiding. They're going to find us. It's like, hey, well, oh, wow. Oh, no, never mind.
This is like cardboard animation. They were kind of like holding each other, you know? The Phoenix shooting.
We almost managed to hide.
All right, so double Robo, Robo Bay. I like the build so far. I would have loved to see 2-3 more Phoenixes. I also kind of feel that these Phoenixes are, like I said, a safety target, as in,
Kev,
please do not go Mutalisk immediately.
What if they go Colossus against the Roach Hydra?
Why do we see double Hydra then here?
Because I want to go Lurkers and get the Muscular Augments at the same time.
Yeah, well, it's Disruptors, and Disruptors should be really good against this. I like this for Protoss again, honestly. Even though the score is 2-0 in favor of NYU, and they have played better so far in the series, I'm not saying it's undeserved, not at all. I like what Laval is doing here, and I really feel that if this was a pro game, you know, and we're looking at, let's say, call an even match, you know, let's say we're looking at Showtime against Nurcho, I wouldn't hate Showtime's position, so to speak. Like, I think this is looking pretty decent for him.
Yeah. And the Disruptors are going to be a big key in taking down the Hydra base play. Yeah, they do get, see, they get the upgrade and the lurker at the same time. Yeah. I don't know if they were planning on doing that, but
no, I think,
I'd like to imagine that.
I think
that
they were.
The plan.
I think you were spot on.
The lurker den does take a long time to morph. It feels like it takes forever.
Yeah, it takes more than a minute.
It's like 79 seconds or 86. Yeah.
Come on, Liv, you've had so much energy. You never want to have a Phoenix full on energy, and it's not full. Nice. Well done. Yeah, I like this. So far, I think this is really solid. Ooh, I wouldn't take this base. I think it's always better to take this base. It's obviously a little harder to defend against run buys, but if lurkers go on the high ground here, things get so annoying.
Funny to think about that siege capability out of the Zerg now.
The roaches will be able to...
Oh,
no, not like that. Not like that.
Damage the pylon, kill the stalker.
Yeah.
Not good.
Yeah, no cancel either. Very unfortunate. Phoenixes will fly in. We'll be able to lift up a couple of roaches. Just imagine. I really do not see it. Oh, God.
Wow.
It's another big link drop.
That multi-prong harass, though. Overlords moving into the main base while that army continues.
Look where the money's
chased by
I would
the
recall. Well, maybe recall is overkill, but.
Well. Yeah.
Okay. I don't mind.
Solid choice.
Yeah. It's better than
a
losing.
Lot of those links didn't unload from the Overlord either.
Yeah, I saw that. 18 Hydralisk on the way. Obviously, 10 or so of them will morph into Lurkers. Like, I would, as much as these Phoenixes, like, helped out a little bit there, I want to see them more active on the other side of the map. I want to see these Phoenixes lift up drones all the time. If you take a look at the economy, it's 83 drones right now for NYU against 63 for Laval. It's not over. This game's absolutely not over. Finally, they've got plus one. They will have plus two, and they've got, you know, a lot of potential in all these disruptors. That's... You know, that's crazy amount of potentials when it comes to damage, but will they be able to get the shots off that they're looking for?
That's
the money shots, Nate.
That's the focus, Kev. Those money shots off those disruptors. We have the first lurker on the map. A few more are going to be coming out as well. Right, and they're just so good at controlling ground.
This is still only... No. You guys don't have to do this. No, I don't like this. Blink almost done, but not that many stalkers right now. Plus two almost done. Templar Archives on the way. Two extra gates. Fourth base almost saturated. I think another link drop is heading to the main base. This fight is very, very, very unnecessary. If they get great hits off, it's always possible, but they just don't have to do this.
Yeah, the link drop's going to head to the main base thing before spend warp-ins defensively.
These are slow warp-ins, no? Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't do that.
Next, you're going to drop the links on that and just kill the stalkers.
We would have been able to kill all five stalkers. So obviously this pylon should be a little bit closer. Do you know there's an icon for pylons in the observer mode?
Yeah, it's called warp conduit.
Yep, conduit.
Yep, turns blue if the pylon is in range of an extra frigate.
Lurkers are scary. Good position on these lurkers, by the way. Not oh no, immortal! No! Okay, that's not how you do disruptors.
That was rough.
Panic, time warp. He's waiting.
Need to lift the lurkers. Okay, pull a few of them out of the ground, but there's still just so much damage being dealt to that army.
Two out of three. One disruptor went down already. The other one is very low in HP. They will shoot all of them together. Get a decent hit off there. A couple of Hydras died.
But I think it's a little too late at that point. Well, they've got
another
disruptor
one
in the back.
Another one.
And another one.
Come on, DJ Khaled.
Okay, reasonable shot. And another one. But it kills his own stalker.
Nope.
That's unfortunate.
Oh, well, I think that this is going to be it. NYU, perhaps just a little bit too good here for the University of Laval. Good upgrades, man. Throughout the entire series, I really feel that upgrade mattered. They've always had an upgrade advantage. This time, they could do it without 2-0. They will start dancing the Hydralisk.
Dancing the Hydras.
Good
brutal
performance by them. Even though this was a 3-0, I felt game one was maybe the most one-sided one. And game two and three, there were very realistic opportunities for Laval to take it down, but unfortunately they were not able to close it out. Perhaps
it was not meant to be, Roddy. They're going to continue to push forward. They're going to continue to deal damage and choke them out until they give up. Crushing their dreams, crushing their army, crushing their base, but the disruptors. At this point, do you think they're just kind of like having fun with it, with the disruptors? Like, how much can we kill? It's like one of those campaign missions.
I think they still believe because disruptors are the ultimate comeback unit.
They
like, they
trading.
Don't have access to the numbers. Like, they don't see what we see.
Yeah, they don't see that the 3K bank.
No. Oh.
They are killing a lot with them. I like that disruptors are like widow mines. They can't hurt each other. And we've coded this to kill everything except ourselves.
Yeah, except when you play PvP. Then one disruptor kills all five of yours.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah. Well, I think that this is going to be it. The writing is absolutely on the wall here. 11 more Hydras on the way, 12 more Roaches. GG is called. Definitely a fun series, though, to start the day off with, despite the fact that NYU takes a 3-0 victory over Laval. I think the games were pretty fun and entertaining.
Yeah, pretty solid. I still wanted to see the carriers again, but I don't mind seeing disruptor shots either.
They could have made it work. I swear to God.
It's... Disruptors are just one of my favorite units to watch because you never know what's going to happen. It's exciting. But
I think the factor that disruptors can kill, you know, friendly units as well makes it such a crazy unit.
Yeah.
You've seen it even at the highest level every now and then. You see an army move forward and then you see a disruptor shot. And I don't think it matters how experienced you are. There's always that sheer moment of panic where, no, move away from my disruptable.
Yeah, gets unfortunate. And of course, we can see highlight from that last game as the Phoenix did what they could, but that early pressure here and there, and just this army, this battle did not go well for them.
Of course,
you mentioned it, the slowdown as the Immortal eats pavement.
That was well done, man. Like slow mo action. And also, you never really want to shoot with all four disruptors at the same time because it means.
You want to be able to chain them so that your opponent doesn't attack into you.
Like, it's very, very hard to attack into a Protoss with disruptors because if the army just runs away but shoots a disruptor ball forward one at a time, it's impossible to chase that army.
Yeah.
Like, absolutely impossible.
So, 3-0 for NYU over Laval as they get their first victory of this season.
Mm-hmm.
It feels like, it feels like we're in, it's like week one, right? That's what it is.
It's solid to start off, it's 7 weeks of open season, so you'll be playing 7 best of 5s, but starting off 1-0, it's always a good feeling. We'll see, I'm sure we'll see them again, because they are pretty good, so I expect them to win more, and then eventually maybe week 2 or week 3, week 4 even, I'm sure we'll cast them again, because by then they probably have a pretty good winning record.
Yeah.
Two Master League Zerg players should be able to do pretty well in a collegiate tournament.
Yeah, for sure. I definitely agree. The rest of the matches tonight, the next
Montana.
Match... Montana versus Toronto.
Yeah, even though Montana is very, it sounds cool. I've never been there, but for some reason, I kind of like to go to.
I've never been to Montana, but you think about, what do I think about Montana? It's like,
I think of Montana the same thing as I think of like North Dakota, South Dakota,
yeah,
Wyoming,
a lot of the Midwest.
And Idaho.
a lot of the North Midwest. Yeah.
Montana is actually a very big state.
Yeah.
Yes. I looked at it, it's like, wow. So big.
It's a lot of space, not as many people, but
they go up against
nice
the
place.
Six. You got to cheer for the six. Toronto, city of break.
I my time I've spent in Toronto, I am absolutely in love with that city. I'm a Toronto fanboy. It's true.
Yeah, I'm a Drake fanboy.
Okay.
Views from the six, baby, all day long. All right. It should be good. It's going to be, do we know the races? It's going to be a Protoss and a random, so
like
most
a,
likely
it looks
Protoss.
Like a PvZ, probably.
Could be PvZ or...
Could be PvP, but...
Actually, it could be a PvP. Well, so much Protoss.
I like the notes for Toronto. Hitman Micros and Urban Micros.
Yep.
Okay, they're both just going to micro.
Well, there are 5 teams representing the University of Toronto, by the way.
Yeah.
See, that's why we love Toronto. Starcraft 2 is booming over there.
Yeah. So it's an awesome place. Awesome place. That's going to be the next match, guys, coming up after this break. Big thanks, of course, for watching on Twitch. Thank you to our sponsors, SteelSeries and Gunner Optics. We'll be back after a few minutes.